The second student come. That is the time for me to start my 8th lecture. And for this one, I should start with PowerPoint. And then later, I will demonstrate you the extra example. You guys may pick it up. We move to the new chapter. On this new chapter, we are going to talking about the axial load. There are many structural member subjected to axial load, such as column. Also, you have the truss member. The axial load applied to this kind of member in the form of two force member. And you may thinking about, oh, for column, that's supposed to be in compression. Sure, the column subjected to axial load in the form of compression. But for the truss member, the axial load may apply in the form of tension, also in the form of compression. And in this study, we have the equation causing by the axial load to be the normal stress. The normal stress is going to be the internal, I said, internal axial force, and divided by the cross-sectional area. And then the next chapter two, we have normal stress cause the normal strain. In short, you may say normal stress also occur with the normal strain. And then for this one, you have the deformation, maybe the elongation or contraction divided by the original length. Then we may use these two equations compute the elastic deformation. From chapter one, from chapter two, you have chapter three. On the chapter three for the linear elastic behavior, we have what? We have Hooke's law. For the Hooke's law, we have what? We have sigma equal to modulus of elasticity times strain. Now, you apply the knowledge from chapter one, chapter two into this equation. It's going to be P over A equal to modulus of elasticity times the elastic deformation divided by L. And finally, on the chapter four, you can compute the elastic deformation equal to, oh, sorry, this P, P L over A. E. This is very important equation for this chapter used to determine the elastic deformation of axially loaded member. It may be column, it may be truss member, for example. Okay. And then for the second objective, we're going to talking about the principle of superposition. In the analysis of statically indeterminate, okay, we will introduce the new concept. But before I go to this one, I should say, for our first learning objective, all the structure that we study is called statically determinate. What is the name of this one? The statically determinate axially loaded member is the kind of the member you can analyze based on our knowledge of free body diagram and equation of equilibrium. That's going to be the first portion. And then when you get this equation, let me put it properly. Equilibrium. And then when the structure is more complicated, more complex. Okay, the structure may change from statically determinate that's cancelled by using free body diagram and equation of equilibrium to be statically indeterminate. Everybody know in kind of the word of not. Okay, you cannot only use the free body diagram and equation of equilibrium to solve this kind of statically indeterminate axial loaded member. For example, if you have the column like this one, this column is called statically determinate. However, under this column, you change the column to be this kind of column. Let me put it in the light blue. And then you put the support on the top and put the support on the bottom, and the structure subjected to the load at the middle. This second one, we call it statically indeterminate. Okay, we will first study statically determinate in this lecture. And next lecture on next Tuesday, we will talking about the statically indeterminate structure. And then we going to use a special method called the displaced method to solve the statically indeterminate structure by writing what's so called compatibility condition. You may have many conditions as you wish to analyze this statically indeterminate. We will talking about this one later. And then the condition based on the displacement or based on the deformation of the structure. That's the name is called displaced method. And the last one, actually, we also analyze the structure subjected to temperature change, such as the thrust on the roof of the structure subjected to the sunlight in the daytime. It's going to be hot, okay? But in the night, the temperature cool down, temperature change, okay, is also affect the structure. In conclusion, we will have two types of structure in this subject. One, statically determinate. Another one, statically indeterminate. The new equation offered here is going to be the equation for elastic deformation. You may have this one from Hooke's law from chapter 3, and Hooke's law also related to the equation for chapter 1. Now, if you consider we have some homework that's going to be statically determinate, this one is statically determinate. Okay, and we have this one for statically indeterminate, and statically indeterminate, and statically indeterminate. Most of the homework is statically indeterminate, okay? That means most of the problem in the midterm examination gonna be statically indeterminate. However, before you can understand statically indeterminate, you should be able to compute, analyze, and decide statically determinate first. The example for the statically determinate is the column that we have discussed from the previous lecture. We have the column used in this house and two-story house. The first is the green column, and the second is going to be the red column. And column is a kind of axially loaded member. And again, due to the construction, you may use your imagination. The weight of this kind of structure, they will distribute into this column. And the load from the floor also over here will be applied, transferred to this portion of the column. And you can see this kind of axially loaded member caused the compressive load transfer from the fore and the beam to the column. The compressive load caused what? The compressive load caused the compressive normal stress sigma equal to the internal axial force divided by A. And not only that, the compressive load also caused the compressive strain. Again, you have normal strain equal to delta over L. And in engineering, such as CE or ME, material has linear elastic behavior. So sigma equal E times normal strain. And then you put it together, P over A, P over, okay, sorry for that. I got to take it back. Okay, take it. I should like it in the area close to it. Let me put it again in the form of P over A. We got to get P over A equal to E delta over L. Then you got delta equal to PL over AE again. This is the important equation. You don't need to remember it. You just use the knowledge from chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3 to write this equation for chapter 2. Don't need to remember it. Okay. And then the task also, again, the task have what? Has the force applied to the joists and some of the task member, such as I show over here, the member is in tension, right? You put it like this one, the top is in tension. And then part of the task over here, 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 they are in compression. So the task have both tension and compression is more complex than the column. Before we go to analyze this kind of structure, we should talking about one important principle. The principle is called Seng-Wonnong principle. We talking about the condition when the force applied to the axially loaded member. However, the application of the force may be to the bow. And from the first chapter, we have considered the connection and the stress over the connection area is going to be very complicated. Okay. But it's only complicated to a small area. Then following the note from Seng-Wonnong, it said the stress and the strain occur in structural member area that is located far away from the load and the support, far away from this point, and this point can be considered as the average normal stress. So all of the normal stresses we will compute based on this one. And later, when you study the subject of the steel design and you consider the connection, the stress that occur over here, the stress occur over here, sigma max may be 3 times of the sigma average. Then following the steel design, you need to design the connection basis upon this equation, not basis upon our average normal stress equation over here. Now, basis upon again this equation, let us start our consideration from the chapter 1. We have the average normal stress in the column by using this equation. From the real structure, as the engineer, you should be able to model the column that I just mentioned in the form like this one. Again, we have the knowledge of this one. We can compute the normal stress by cutting the column. And then we determine the internal force on each column segment. This one, we have P over A. This one, we have PA plus PB. And then we can compute for the stress. What we have next?On the application of this force, this point A should move to A prime because our material is a kind of deformable materials. When you talking about steel materials, concrete, or any kind of engine material, it's a deformable material. Then the B also have this kind ofDeformation B prime, and then what happened? We got to have the reference. Most of the time for the column, we have this one for the reference. We reference our column basis on the column foundation. We assume the foundation of the column is very strong. Okay, no movement.Under application of the force, then the deformation occur over here will be the delta at point A with respect to C. Okay, and then over here we will have the deformation of point B with respect to C. Then.We use the same equation that you just mentioned for this portion of the column. We will have the P sub A. Okay, P sub A. P sub A. And then time the length L1. L1 is over here. And then E1. And then plus the area.A1 from our previous consideration. And not only this one, it also has the additional deformation plus over here, delta B slash C. Okay. And what is going to be delta B slash C? Delta B slash C is going to be the force over here. We will have PA plusPB, and then L2 over what? Over E2 and A2. Now, not only the normal stress, you guys are supposed to be able to determine the axial deformation of the columns. And then let me move your come to this one.We have again this equation, and this equation come from what? Come from Hooke's law. Okay, in the elastic region, Hooke's law apply, and then we have P over A equal to E delta over L. You really like it? You get the elastic deformation in the form like this one. The next step, how to relate?The deformation to the reference line, like I just show you guys from the previous slide. Now, again, there is two portion, and then there is the deformation occur on this one, the deformation of A slash B. That's only cause the deformation on the top portion, and the second is going to be delta B slash C.When we talking about this one, delta B slash C gonna be this one. However, when we talking about the top portion over here, this is delta A slash C. And in short, this is going to be delta A slash B plus delta B slash C. And this one is going to be only delta B slash C. Okay, the consideration of the deformationis different from the stress. The stress is only occur in the portion. Okay. If you said, I like to determine stress in the AB, sigma sub AB will be P sub A over A1. Okay. And stress in the BC is going to be P sub A plus P sub B divided by A2. No additional of the stress. I like the deformation. Okay. When the top consider, you start by consider the bottom first. Let's say the bottom may have this one for 1 millimeter and its own deformation may be 1 millimeter. So the total deformation going to be 2 millimeter. And then following this one, the deformation of the structure is the total deformation of the structure is the summation of the deformation of each member. Then let me talking about the problem. There are three problems involved with the axially loaded member. Let me start by the first. We have this equation. Okay, so we can analyze to determine the axial displacement, maybe only delta A slash B, maybe only delta B slash C, and maybe delta A slash C. Okay, depend on what Ajahn asks you, but you guys should differentiate between what I write over here. A with respect to B, B with respect to C, and A with respect to C. Okay, it's different type of combination. And then you also should be able to do analysis for the stress sigma equal to P over A, tau equal to V over A. We have done that before on the chapter 1. Okay. And then we have one point B. On the one point B, we write this equation, delta equal to PL over AE. Now, we just change this one, P equal to delta AE over L. We got this equation. From this equation, you can determine P. P is going to be internal axial load. Okay, and then later, you may use this one to determine the external applied load. That's applied to our structure. Okay, the same thing. From this equation, you get P. This one supposed to be P. P equal to sigma A. The same one over here. V equal to tau A. And then you should say, this tau is tau allow. This one also sigma allow. Then this one gonna be the allowable axial displacement. And then we have the design. In the design, we use this equation again, but now we really like it. A equal to PL over E delta. And following this one, delta gonna be the allowable, and then you can compute for the cross-sectional area of the axially loaded member. The same thing occur coming to this one. A is going to be P over sigma allow. And also this one, the connection, A is going to be V over tau allow. Now, the analysis and design of the axially loaded member expand to include what? To include the deformation of the structure. Okay, and then the structure such as this one is a good example for us to consider. However, let me move you to what we have in the paper. I prefer to do the hand calculation more than use the PowerPoint. Let us move to my midterm examination many years ago. Okay, I select the axially loaded structural member in the form of column, and it is the model of two-story building. Okay, and based on this one, you guys should know this is going to be roof. Okay, the roof of our structure, and then following this one, this is going to be our second floor, and for sure we have this one gonna be our first floor. Okay, and what we have over here is going to be the building that's built by the A36 steel, and I should mention for the A36 steel is a kind of structural steel used in the US system, and most of this steel has the yielding stress not larger than, not more than, should be larger than 250 megapascal. When we talking about metamaterial, we should start by consider this mechanical property of the material, and then the structure subjected to symmetric load. For sure, the beam, no, actually it should be the floor transfer the force to this, let's call, it's not the beam, it's called joist is a small cast structure, and it behave like a beam. Okay, and it's called joist. In Thai, it's called tong. Okay, and then the force over here transfer to this point for P1, and the joist over here transfer to this portion, and it said symmetrics. What it mean is you have the axial of the column. Then by using this one, you may think this one has the same eccentricity. What occur is the moment due to this one and the moment due to this one, they are equal and in the opposite direction. So the result of the moment occur at A due to P1 and P2 gonna be zero. So based upon this one, summation of the moment due to the loading is gonna be zero for P1. And for P2 also, the summation of the moment gonna be zero. Okay, now we move to the structure. Our structure has two floor. Okay, has two floor. I just mentioned about it already. They asked us to determine what? To determine the deformation or the vertical displacement occur on the top of this one. For sure, as I have mentioned before, the A supposed to change to this A palm, and the B also supposed to move into this B palm. And then following, we have discussed under the application of the force P1 is 200 kilonewton, and P2 is 300 kilonewton. The deformation occur, and I should say based on this one, the deformation that occur over here is going to be B reference to C. So this is going to be delta B with respect to C. Okay, and then for this one, A with respect to C, this is going to be delta A with respect to C. And I should say the delta A with respect to C is the combination of the delta B with respect to C plus delta A with respect to B. Okay, this one gonna be the combination of the deformation of the column on the second floor. This is going to be axial deformation of second floor, column, and this is going to be the axial deformation of the first floor, and then column. You can understand this one clearly, right? Okay, on the roof, you got to consider the deformation of two portion on the first floor and on the second floor. But for point B, the deformation only occur on the column on the first floor. Okay, now what you gonna do? Again, we come back to our equation. We have sigma equal to E epsilon, and then we have P over A equal to E delta over L, and our delta is gonna be PL over AE. You will use this equation under the condition that the behavior of the steel is in linear elastic behavior. Then you got to check. So we got to check the condition is gonna be okay or not. How to check it? First, we got to draw the free body diagram of column segment. We got to draw both segment A, C, and also the A, B, C. Then let me put this one as the reference. I cut this one. We have this portion of AB, okay, in this free body diagram. And then this is going to be our A. Then this is going to be the second floor. We cut this one to this point. We have another free body diagram of the column. And this is going to be A. This is going to be B. The important thing is all of this free body diagram have the axial line that's passing to the centroid of the section. And then on the top, you have what? You have the force 2, P2. The combination of them going to be 400 kilonewton on both point A. And then at the point B, you have the force, the combination cockpit going to be 600 kilonewton. Okay, now you can write the axial force occur in the column segment. This is for the segment AB. So this is gonna be F sub AB. And this one is for the segment BC. We call this F sub BC. Okay, and now we start to use plus, and compute the what's so called internal and axial root. Let me call this one. We're gonna find internal axial force. That is gonna be F sub AB and F sub BC. Now, based upon what we have, again, you should start by summation of X sub X equal to 0, since there is no horizontal horizontal process automatically correct and then the second one summation of the moment at any point equal to zero due to symmetric load okay I mentioned about the symmetric load already right the moment occur gonna be zero symmetric loads and then the last one you make use the summation of f sub y equal to zero upward is positive now this one gonna be easy it's gonna be 400 kilo newton and for the other one you may do the same thing summation of f sub y equal to zero upward is positive now your f sub bc will be this one 400 plus this one 600 and then it's gonna be 1000 kilonewton okay and again we got to check the stresses occur in the segment of the column then the second one we determine the sigma sub AB let's say sigma sub AB and also determine sigma sub BC and you should check whether it's in linear elastic or not then following this one sigma sub AB is going to be F sub AB divided by the A sub AB. Now, we move to the problem. The problem said the column has the cross-sectional area of 0.015 square millimeter. Okay, if you prefer, you may use square millimeter. But for me, I prefer to use square millimeter. Then we have what? We have 1 meter equivalent to 1,000 square millimeter. Then when you square this one, 1 square meter is going to be equivalent to 10^6 square millimeter. So our A will equal to 0.015 square meter times 10^6 square millimeter per square meter cut okay we just move this one A is going to be 15,000 square millimeter it's okay right think if not it's okay you may use meter if you prefer but for me I prefer to use newton and square millimeter in order to get the megapascal now you have what this one f sub ab so that is going to be 400,000 newton 400 kilonewton change to 400,000 newton and then you get the area that is going to be 15,000 square millimeter 1 2 3 1 2 3 is going to be 400 divided by 15 you get 26.67 this one is going to be 26.67 megapascal and then that's one smaller than sigma sub y okay that is going to be 250 megapascal or I should say or it should be less than sigma allowable depend on which value given in the problem statement okay both of them linear elastic now we move to the second one sigma sub bc this is sigma sub bc then
we have f sub bc divided by this f sub bc a sub bc that is gonna be 1 million newton and then divided by 15,000 square millimeter so it's gonna be 1,000 divided by 15 okay and then you guys should get what yeah 66.67 you should get that and then this is also less than the yielding stress and the allowable stress now you can use this equation because the condition is okay the third we're going to determine the deformation of each portion let me take the deformation of this portion first okay if you consider the deformation determine then the axial deformation of what of the column of the column segment and if you say this one you determine the axial deformation that means you determine delta okay and then for the yellow that's going to be delta a with respect to b this is going to be the yellow and then if you consider another portion this is going to be our orange portion so you going to be determine again it's going to be determine the deformation of b with respect to c and then the total deformation is going to be the delta of a the top the a with respect to the reference c okay the delta a slash c is going to be equal to delta a slash b of the yellow column and then it's going to be plus the delta b slash c of the orange portion is that clear for you okay it's separate right now how to compute the first one let me start with this one delta a slash b the deformation of point a with respect to b let's do b I may show it a little bit I'm going over here it should be clearer this is going to be what only in this portion right so it's going to be f sub a b l sub a b divided by e we use the same one so e going to be e of the steel okay e of steel is going to be 210 power 3 mega pascal okay this one 210 power 3 mega pascal and then what we have a sub a b now just put them together this is going to be 400,000 newton times the length this is going to be meter since you use millimeter you got to change this one to be okay 4,000 millimeter and then you divide it by e sub st that is going to be your 210 power 3 newton per square millimeter and then the area you get this one that is going to be 15 1,000 square millimeter. And what you guys get? This one cut, okay? And this one cut. You get this one in millimeter. So put this one, you get the answer of this one to be in millimeter. You may cut three of this by 10 power 3. You may cut three of this by this one. Okay, so you should get it to be 0.51. Did you get that? 400 times 4 divided by 210 divided by 15. You got to get this one only, yeah, very small. Okay. Can you put it in your finger for 0.5 millimeter? That would be very small, right? Okay. That is the first portion. Second portion, we're talking about orange. Delta B Selassie. And then based upon this one, you got F sub B C, L sub B C divided by E sub S T and A sub B C. You have the force over here for 1,000,000 Newton and have the length of 4,000 millimeter divided by the area. No, E first, 210 power 3 Newton per square, and then the area of 15,000 square millimeter, and then again, you guys will get the deformation of the column on the first floor. This is for the first floor. This is for the second floor. You have this one for, I have this one for 1.26. Okay. And I should say both of them going to be contraction, or you may say that should be the shortening of the column. And then for the total now, and then for the total, delta A over C total going to be equal to 0.51. And then plus 1.26, you will get the total. This one going to be 1.77 millimeter. Okay. And then for the application of the force, this one is going to be 1.77 millimeter. And this one is going to be only this one, 1.26 millimeter. Okay, you can see that, right? And how about the length? L, A, B, C, palm. This is going to be 8,000 4 meter minus 1.77. So the total length of the column gonna be what? You get the length. 7,998.23. Okay. It's gonna be 0.23. 7,998.23 reduced for 8,000. Okay. And that is what I said. Analysis 1.A. This is going to be your analysis 1.A. And then Ajahn move this one to the analysis 1.B. Let me move to the next one, the same problem. But now we said the top portion of this one, if the A, top A, move downward for 3 millimeter, they said by doing one, this one should move to 3 millimeter. And then the point B, move to 2.3 millimeter. Now the problem is like this one. Let me move this one up. And you said the green over here, the deformation here is going to be 3 millimeter. And following this one is going to be the deformation of a slash C, right? This on top. And this deformation again is going to be the deformation of this first portion. Let me say it. This is going to be, let me put this one in back, delta A slash C. And it's going to be the deformation of delta A slash B. And then again, the same thing that we have over here, plus delta B slash C. The same equation over here. But it said this one can be 3.0 millimeter. Now, moving to this portion, okay, we also have the deformation over here. But this one going to be the deformation of B slash C. And it can be only 2.3 millimeter. 2.3 millimeter. That's what Ajahn translate, what said over here to be what we consider in this paper. And then they ask us to determine the load P1 and P2. Remember, one point A, you determine stress, you determine deformation. One point B, you determine the applied loading. Let's be going to determine it based upon the given information. A is going to be 15,000 square millimeter, and E sub ST over here, E sub ST over here, going to be 210^3. And you guys know this going to be in megapascal. The same thing, the same thing. Now, what should you do? You got to check first. You got to draw the free body diagram. First, we do the same thing I write about it already. You got to draw the free body diagram and use equation of equilibrium to determine the internal, axial forces. Okay, that is going to be our main duty. Following this one, again, we got to draw the free body diagram the same. What we have, let me do it again for you. This is going to be our first portion. And then we may put this one in the reference of X and Y axis. Now, the force applied on the top of this one is going to be 2P1. 2P1. It's not the number. And then you cut this one to the second portion. And then you may draw another free body diagram. And this one, our column subjected to this 2P1. And also this one, 2P2. Now, the applied loading is going to be the unknown. Okay, we're going to determine it. Now, following the same procedure that we have This is going to cause our F sub A B. And the same thing, summation of X sub X automatically correct. Summation of the moment equal to zero automatically correct. I won't mention the reason. The reason is on the first example. And then we have the internal force for this one for F sub BC. And you do the same for summation of F sub Y equal to zero. Your F sub AB going to be 2P1. And the same thing, summation of F sub Y equal to zero. F sub BC will be 2P1 plus 2P2. Okay, you get the internal axial forces basis upon this. Okay, second one, we determine the second one. We start to determine P1 and P2. Determine P1 and P2. And what you should mention basis on, okay, what we have delta A slash C equal to 3 millimeter. We have we have what? We go to our first portion over here, delta A slash C, and then it's going to be equal to this one, delta A slash B, and then plus delta B slash C. Okay, and then if you guys put this one together, as I just mentioned over here, put this one, the first one is going to be F sub A B, L sub A B, divided by E sub ST, and the same A, the same A, A equal. And then for the second one, plus this one, F sub B C time L. Actually, L also equal. Let me eliminate this one, time L. And then divided by E sub ST, and then A. Okay, this one should be equal to 3.0 millimeter. Now you can see these coefficients, they are the same. You may write this one, F sub A B plus F sub B C. And then you have this one to be L. L over E sub ST A equal to 3. Okay, rearrange this one. Ajahn Chao always said, Ajahn Si Chai, when you teach students, you should show them how to compute. I said, Ajahn, this thing is old, good old day. Not my duty. I'm engineering professor. I'm not high school teacher. But okay, let us move, okay? Just move this one, you will get F sub AB, F sub AB plus F sub BC equal to 3 time E sub ST time A over L. Okay, now what we have is it's going to be 3 millimeter. E sub ST is going to be 210 power 3 newton per square meter. And then A is going to be 15,000 square millimeter and divided by L of 4,000 millimeter. And you guys may have this one square, take it out, meter, take it out. So the unit is going to be in the newton. You're going to get F sub A B plus F sub B C and then equal to put it together 210 power 3 just cut okay 210 times 15,000 divided by 4 you should get this one to be 2362 and 500 Newton. Okay, 2362. And then what you have is this is going to be 2T1 and this is going to be 2P1 plus 2P2. So finally, you should get this is going to be 4P1 plus 2P2 equal to this number. And then you may rearrange this equation again. That is going to be P1, 2P1 plus P2 divided by 2. This one going to be 181,250. And that's going to be our first equation. Okay, we have first equation. We have the second condition. Again, we move to basis on second condition over here. Okay, delta B slash C equal to 2.3 millimeter we have. So we have what? We have delta B slash C, the same over here. Delta B slash C equal to the same over here. F sub B C L. And then divided by E sub S T A. And then this is going to be 2.3 millimeter. Again, you do the arrangement. F sub BC is going to be equal to 2.3 millimeter times E sub STA divided by L. Now, F sub BC is what? F sub BC is 2P1 plus 2P2 is going to be 2.3 millimeter times E, 210 times 10^3 Newton per square millimeter. And then A, that is going to be 15,000 square millimeter, and then divided by L of 4,000 millimeter. Now you should get the number for P1 plus P2. You may cut this one and put 2 over here. Put 2 over here. So that is going to be P1 plus P2 equal to this P. You may cut and you put everything into this one. This one cut to be 105. And then that's going to be 905. 905 and 600 Newton. That's going to be equation number 2. Okay, now you have 2 equations. You got to solve the simultaneous equation by solving the say the equation simultaneous equation. We have P1 275.65. P1 is going to be 2 7.5 and 6.50 newton and said this is going to be 275.65 kilonewton. Okay, and then you also have P2 is going to be 629 and 950 newton, or it should be 629.95 kilonewton. When you get P1 and P2, you cannot finish the calculation. What you should do is check the condition. How we use this equation? Linear, elastic. Okay, so the last one you got to do, that is 1, 2, 3. Okay, compute sigma sub BC and sigma sub AB and check if sigma sub BC and sigma sub AB is in linear elastic behavior. You got to check. Okay, now the sigma sub AB is going to be F sub AB. It's going to be F sub AB divided by the A. F sub AB is what? 2P1. So 2 times P1. 275.65 newton. And then divided by the area. The area of what? The area is the same. 15,000 square millimeter. You will get sigma sub AB to be 36.75 megapascal. And then again, this is less than sigma sub Y. Okay, it's gonna be okay. You gotta check. And then for sigma sub BC, it's gonna be F sub BC divided by A. Now, F sub BC is like this one. Okay, you got to put this one 2 times P1, 275.65 plus 2 times P2, 2 times 629.950 and newton, and then divided by 15,000 square millimeter, and then you will get this one to be 1811 and 200 divided by 15,000 square millimeter, and this is going to be 120.75 megapascal, and then it is less than sigma sub y and also less than sigma allowed, which is 125 megapascal. Okay, that is the analysis 1.B. It's quite complicated test problem. I think you guys can do it. Okay, it's not that tough. It just requires some analysis skill, and for sure, you should be able to do so. And not enough for that. We still have what? We still have the psi problem, right? So let's take 5 minutes break.
Guys, let me start our second session on the design of the column, and let me change something to the first problem. In the design, now we are looking for the cross-sectional area. So we are looking for the area of the column, what is going to be. And the same occur. Let us consider the same column. This column, again, subjected to the axially loaded. And for loading this one, let me say the load P1 is going to be 200 kilonewton as before, and P2 also 300 kilonewton. And as you may recall, we have stress equal to internal force divided by the area. And for the design problem, you got to be removed, move A to be this one. And then that is going to be the internal force divided by the sigma allowable. So based upon this one, Ajahn should provide one more thing. That is going to be sigma allowable. And then on the design, when the construction of two-story building, if you go downstairs, take a look at that column. Most of the column for low-rise building has the same cross-section. Okay, so you got to determine this one for the P-max that occur over here or occur over here first to get the maximum cross-sectional area. Okay, and then I said for the A36 steel, we have sigma sub y to be 250 megapascal. And then Ajahn should provide one more thing to determine the sigma allowable. Ajahn got to provide you with the safety factor. Okay, let's see. We have a kind of safety factor for the building. Safety factor must be at least, L-E-A-S-T, at least 2.0. It can be larger, but it cannot smaller than 2.0. Okay, now, for this one, let me start the second one. We have another set of equation. Delta equal to PL over AE. Now, for this one, you got to change this one for the A. For this one, you have what? You have equal to PL over modulus of elasticity and time delta. And delta is going to be delta allowable. And most of the time, you got to check the delta allowable with respect to the design code. Okay, we have this kind of design code in our profession. For the steel, you have the steel design code. Now, you got to have two areas. One is based on the strength of steel. This one based on the strength of the steel. Another one is called based on the stiffness of the column. Okay, most of the time we specify delta allowable in the form of delta at the roof with respect to at the foundation at the roof. So delta A at the roof with respect to the foundation. This is going to be foundation. Okay, the reference. And then let me
put this one to be what I put this one 2 millimeter let put this one to be 2.0 and millimeter now you have two condition then you got to compare this is the area okay basis upon strength of the steel this is going to be the area basis upon the stiffness how to select it pick the larger one okay in the design we always pick the larger one okay let me start the same thing first you got to draw the free body diagram of the columns segment okay and then you use the and determine internal axial forces you may use the equation of equilibrium if you prefer do the same thing just the same thing you may bother with me about drawing this one but I should do it for the completeness of my lecture and then following this portion you have 400 kilonewton and again you have this one for your A sub A B and then summation of F sub Y equal to zero this F sub A B again gonna be 400 kilonewton and you should say summation of X sub X equal to zero automatically correct no horizontal force summation of the moment equal to zero due to symmetric loading if you prefer to give some reason behind your computation and then you do the second free body diagram and draw the same column but now you cut it over here this is A this is B you get the same one the force must apply to the axial of the column this is 400 kilonewton and again this is gonna be 300-600 kilonewton and you get your F sub BC and then for the summation of the F sub Y equal to zero F sub BC gonna be 400 plus 600 equal to 1000 kilonewton and now you are ready to do the design basis upon the static okay let me start by doing the determine A okay or design basis on the strength of steel now what's going to be the factor of safety and let me use the 2.5 basis on this one you will get sigma allow for this one gonna be 250 megapascal divided by 2.5 you will get this one to be 100 megapascal or 100 newton per square millimeter and then what's going to be the largest you got to put P max okay you have this one larger than this one so your A is going to be A sub B C for the portion of this one of the column you have 1000 kilonewton larger than the top one and then that's going to be P max 1 million newton and then divided by this one 100 Newton per square meter. Oh, sorry. Newton. Newton per square millimeter. Now, Newton, cut Newton, and then millimeter, just move up to this one. What did you get? This one cut. This one cut. You have 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the column supposed to be 10,000 square millimeter. Okay, that's basis on the strength of the steel. And if I can use only 2.0, this one gonna get 125. If you divide this one by 125, this one should get smaller. Okay, use larger factor of safety, get larger section, safer, more expensive. Okay, more expensive. Now, you got to do next for the third. Okay, determine A, basis on the stiffness of the column. Now, the delta allowable not only consider for the orange, you got to consider both portion, the yellow and the orange. Now you have the delta of a slushy from A with respect to C is gonna be equal to the delta of a slash B plus the delta of B slash C. If you make a note on this, this is A, this is C. When combined, the B just neutral itself, and then you get A over C. And this is what? This is gonna be 2.0 millimeter, and it's gonna be equal to the first one. This is going to be A sub A B. You use the same L. And then we have what? We have the same E. Okay. And F L over A. We're looking for the A. Okay, this one, we're looking for the A. The same thing. For this one, you got to plus the second one. This one, F sub BC time L over E sub ST, and then divided by A. Okay, so we have what? We have the same multiplier. We have the same. Okay, so if you do this one, you may rearrange this one equal to F sub A B plus F sub B C, and then you have L over E over A and E sub ST. That's gonna be 2.0 millimeter. Okay, and then you do again. For what? You take the A up, so A E sub ST divided by L time 2.0 millimeter, and then you get F sub AB to be 400,000 Newton, and then F sub BC, you get this one for 1,000,000 Newton. Okay, and you're looking for what? Looking for A. So A is going to be this number, going to be 1,400,000 Newton. And time again, time the L. L is going to be 4,000 millimeter. And then divided by 2.0 millimeter and 2 and 10 power 3 newton per square millimeter. Now, if you make a note on this one, n cut n millimeter cut millimeter, so you have this one to be millimeter square. Oh, sorry for that. Sorry for that. Millimeter square. Now you get what? A gonna be 13,330 square millimeter. And then what you gonna use? You gonna use the A from this one. Okay, and then you get the design result. And if you prepare to build your own steel house, it doesn't hard, right? You can do it for the column now. And when you finish chapter 6, you can design the beam. And then you finish the whole subject, you can design actually the floor, if the floor is precast pre-stressed concrete floor, because that floor going to design such as the beam. Then design the beam, design the column, you can design the metal sheet and the purlin pair. The purlin also a kind of beam. So when you finish this one, actually you can design the steel structure. But preliminary design, you got to follow the design code anyway. So what we have over here, remember the number of 13,330. Let me move you to this one. There are examples in my lecture, and I should say this is the same analysis 1.A. Okay, I like you guys to go to all of this, just changing the number. You can do it by the same analysis procedure. Draw the free body diagram, determine the internal axial forces that occur in the column. And after you get the axial forces, you got to determine the first one, the maximum compressive stress. And then you will get this one, which less than the yielding stress. That means the column is in linear elastic behavior. And then you can determine the total deformation of the column. That's going to be only 2.2 millimeter. And I should ask you again, what is going to be the total L, okay, of this column after the deformation? And then we have the diagram showing the first four. This is going to be delta B slash C is only 1.3 millimeter. And this is going to be A slash C, and it's going to be 2.2 millimeter. The symbol here is important for the next lecture. Okay. The deformation at point A with respect to point C, for example. You got to understand the physical meaning of this one. And then we have the design problem. The same thing. You got to know the yielding stress and factor of safety. You can determine the sigma allowable. Okay. And you also require to have this one for delta allowable. This is going to be 3 millimeter, since you got to do the same thing, get the internal axial forces, and then you can decide it based on strength of the steel. And second one, based on the, oh, this is wrong. This is not 3 millimeter. It's only 2 millimeter. And then we get this one to be 13,000. And when you get 13,000, which one you use? You use the larger. And then when you do this, you got to select the steel section following this one.
the Thailand Industrial Standard. Okay, you got to follow this one. All of the steel company in Thailand, this one from Siam Yamato, SYS. Okay, the reference under kit, not here. And then you got to select, this is smaller. This not, this so small. This one so small. This one so small. This one is okay. Okay. 133 square millimeter is gonna be 13600 square millimeter. You got to time it by 100. 1 centimeter. 1 centimeter equivalent to 10 millimeter. So 1 square millimeter is equivalent to 100 square millimeter. Then you select the steel section with the width and the depth like this one. This one is 300 millimeter width and 400 millimeter depth, and its weight for 107 kilogram per meter. You have 4 meter column segment each, right? So each column segment weigh about 400 something kilograms. And then for each column, the steel cost like 30 baht per kilogram. Okay, so for 1 meter, the steel section here costs you like 3,000 baht. That's only material cost, not include the worker, the welder cost. Okay, so you may select the section with the larger. So it's always larger compared to design. You select the larger, right? And then you open the steel manual to select the section. The section you select gonna get bigger. That for the lecture of this chapter 4. Next lecture 9, I will move you guys to statically indeterminate. And then the concept of elastic deformation still used a lot in that session. Any question? Okay, that's all for today.